what's behind. Got no way to prove it, so maybe I'm lying. But I'm only human after all. I'm only human after all. Don't put your blame on me.
Hey.
Don't put your blame on me. When you look in the mirror, what do you see? Do you see it clearer, or are you deceived? In what you believe? Cause I'm only human after all. You're only human after all. Don't put the blame on me. Don't put your blame on me. Some people got the real problem. Some people out of love. Some people think I can solve them. But Lord, heaven's above. I'm only human after all. I'm only human after all. Don't put the blame on me. Don't ask my opinion, don't ask me to lie, and beg for forgiveness for making you cry, making you cry. Cause I'm only human after all. I'm only human after all. Don't put your blame on me. Don't put the blame on me. Some people got the real problems. Some people think I can solve them. Lord, heaven's above. I'm only human after all. I'm only human after all. Don't put the blame on me. Don't put the blame on me. I'm only human.
12 cards for today for all of the zodiac. Let's see what's good with our energy as we start this practice this morning. As we start this practice, the message is healing. The frequency of healing supports our intrinsic ability to restore our health and wholeness by consciously using the information that comes to us through our senses and harmonizing everything accordingly. Our intrinsic ability to restore our health and wholeness by consciously using the information that comes through us, through our senses, through the messages, through our family, through our ancestors, through our spirit guides, and harmonizing everything together. If you watched if you heard the weekly reading, it was a lot about those messages. It was about coming into harmony and fullness. And so let's get into this this morning stretch, yo. Let's do it. Some music.
My love, where can you Left arm, right knee. tucked in your corner of the sky. Fall right back into place before the sunrise. You need more bullets for your gun. Shoot from a distance, I'm not one to confide. Boy, you better take this pain till you grow with my. Come on and dive in to the deep end. Tell me what could go wrong. Oh, I'm hoping that you feel so. All the angels have been sending on. Jumping off the moon, babe, just to get back down. I'm hoping that you catch me before I hit the ground.
Left arm over right knee, right arm behind your back, and let's twist. Inhale. Exhale. Inhale. Exhale. Inhale. Smile. Some of us woke up very serious today. Inhale. Forward fold. Try to come down as far as you can. Inhale. Exhale. Inhale. Exhale. Inhale, exhale. Come on. Inhale, exhale, come forward, let's come forward. Let's
Stretch it out. Walk your hands out as far as you can. Inhale. Exhale. Inhale. Exhale. Come back.
Go ahead and you can stay in seated meditation, or you can lay in corpse. Get comfortable. Hug a pillow. And set an intention for today. How we want to move today, what we want to attract today, what you want to accomplish today. As you meditate and pray and set your intentions, I'm going to read from Bell Hooks' book. Chapter 4, we're reading all about love, bell hooks. Commitment, let love be love in me, open quote. Commitment is inherent in and genuinely loving, let me start again. Commitment, let love be love in me. Commitment is inherent in any genuinely loving relationship. Anyone who is truly concerned for the spiritual growth of another knows, consciously or instinctively, that he or she can significantly foster that growth only through a relationship of constancy. One more time. Commitment, true commitment, real commitment, long-lasting commitment, is inherent in any genuinely loving relationship, intimate or platonic. Anyone who is truly concerned for the spiritual growth of another knows consciously or instinctively that he or she can significantly foster that growth only through a relationship of constancy. By M. Scott Peck. Commitment to truth. Commitment to truth telling. lays the groundwork for the openness and honesty that is the heartbeat of love. When we can see ourselves as we truly are and accept ourselves, we build the necessary foundation for self-love. We have all heard the maxim, if you do not love yourself, you will be unable to love anyone else. It sounds good, yet more often than not, we feel some degree of confusion when we hear this statement. The confusion arises because most people who think they are not lovable have this perception because at some point in their lives, they were socialized to see themselves as unlovable by forces outside their control. We are not born knowing how to love anyone, either ourselves or somebody else. However, we are born able to respond to care. As we grow, we can give and receive attention, affection, and joy. Whether we learn how to love ourselves and others will depend on the presence of a loving commitment. Self-love cannot flourish in isolation. It is no easy task. It is no easy task to be self-loving. Simply axioms that make self-love sound easy only make matters worse. It leaves many people wondering why, if it's so easy, they continue to be trapped by feelings of low self-esteem or self-hatred. Using a working definition of love that tells us it is the action we take on behalf of our own or another's spiritual growth provides us with a beginning blueprint for working on the issue of self-love. When we see love as a combination of trust, commitment, care, respect, knowledge, and responsibility, we can work on developing these qualities, or if they are already a part of who we are, we can learn to extend them to ourselves. Many people find it helpful to critically examine the past, particularly childhood, to chart their internalization of messages that they were not worthy, not enough, that they were crazy, stupid, monstrous, and so on. Simply learning how we have acquired feelings of worthlessness. Simply learning how we have acquired feelings of worthlessness rarely enables us to change things. It is usually only one stage in the process. I, like so many other people, have found it useful to examine negative thinking and behavioral patterns learned in childhood, particularly those shaping my sense of self and identity. However, this process alone did not ensure self-discovery. It was not enough. I share this because it's far too easy to stay stuck in simply describing, telling one story over and over and over and over and over and over again, which can be a way of holding on to grief about the past, or holding on to a narrative that places blame on others. While it is important for us to understand the origins of fragile self-esteem, it is also possible to bypass this stage, identifying when and where we received negative socialization, and still create a foundation for building self-love. Individuals who bypass this stage tend to move on to the next stage, which is actively introducing ourselves. Individuals who bypass this stage tend to move on to the next stage, which is actively introducing into our lives constructive, life-affirming thought patterns and behavior. Whether a person remembers the details of being abused is not important. When the consequences of that abuse is a feeling of worthlessness, they can still engage in a process of self-discovery by finding ways to affirm self-worth. The wounded heart learns self-love by first overcoming low self-esteem. Nathaniel Branden's lengthy work, Six Pillars of Self-Esteem, highlights important dimensions of self-esteem, the practice of living consciously, self-acceptance, self-responsibility, self-assertiveness, living purposefully, and the practice of personal integrity. The practice of living consciously, self-acceptance, self-responsibility, self-assertiveness, living purposefully, and the practice of personal integrity. We gotta unpack all those, yo. Living consciously means we think critically about ourselves and the world. Here we go. Ready? Living consciously means we think critically about ourselves and the world we live in. We dare to ask ourselves the basic questions: who, what, when, where, and why. Answering these questions usually provides us with a level of awareness that enlightens. Branden contends to live consciously means to seek to be aware. To seek to be aware of everything that bears on our actions, the reasons why we do shit, our purposes, our values, and goals, to the best of our ability, whatever that ability may be, and to behave in accordance with that which we see and know. To live consciously, we have to engage in critical reflection. This is where some of us miss the boat. To live consciously, we engage in critical reflection. We're lacking in the critically reflecting department, many of us, about the world we live in and know most intimately. Usually it is through reflection that individuals who have not accepted themselves make the choice to stop listening to negative voices within and the outside the self. Usually through reflection, individuals who have not accepted themselves make the choice to stop listening to negative voices within and outside themselves that constantly reject and devalue them. This is the reprogramming. This is the reconditioning. This is self-love. This is doing the work. This is shadow work. This is healing. That's the decision to undo all the shit that they would have us believe about ourselves every day. Affirmations work for anyone striving for self-acceptance. Although I had for years been interested in therapeutic modes of healing and self-help, affirmation always seemed to me a bit corny. My sister, who was then working as a therapist in the field of chemical dependency, encouraged me to give affirmations a try to see if I would experience any concrete changes in my outlook. I wrote affirmations relevant to my daily life and began to repeat them in the morning as part of my daily meditations. At the top of my list was the declaration, I'm breaking with old patterns and moving forward with my life. I am breaking with old patterns and moving forward with my life. I am breaking with old patterns and moving forward with my life. I'm breaking with old patterns and moving forward with my life. I not only found them to be tremendous energy boost, I not only found them to be a tremendous energy boost, a way to kick off the day by my accentuating the positive, I also found it useful to repeat them during the day if I felt particularly stressed or was falling into the abyss of negative thinking. Affirmations helped restore my emotional equilibrium. Self-acceptance is hard for many of us. There is a voice inside that is constantly judging first ourselves and then others. That voice enjoys the indulgence of the endless negative critique because we have learned to believe negativity is more realistic. It appears more real than any positive voice. Once we begin to replace negative thinking with positive thinking, it becomes utterly clear that far from being realistic, negative thinking is absolutely disenabling. When we are positive, we not only accept and affirm ourselves, we are able to affirm and accept others. The more we accept ourselves, the better prepared we are to take responsibility in all areas of our life. Taking responsibility. I am taking responsibility for my life. I am taking responsibility for my life. I am taking full responsibility for my life. How does that fucking feel? Commenting on this third pillar of self-esteem, Branden defines self-responsibility as the willingness to take responsibility for my actions and the attainment of my goals for my life and well-being. I am taking responsibility for my actions and my goals for my life and well-being. I take full responsibility for my actions. Someone write that. I am taking full responsibility for my actions and my goals, my life purpose, my vision, my mission, my life and well-being. Hello. Take responsibility does not mean that we deny the reality of institutionalized injustice. For example, racism, sexism, and homophobia all create barriers and concrete incidents of discrimination. Simply taking responsibility does not mean that we can prevent discriminatory acts from happening, but we can choose how we respond to acts of injustice. Boom, pow. You can choose how you respond to any act of injustice, hurt, shame. Taking responsibility means that in the face of barriers, we will have the capacity to invent our lives, to shape our destinies in ways that maximize our well-being. Every day, we practice this shape-shifting to cope with realities we cannot easily change. Oof. Let's finish this section. Many women are married to men who were unsupportive when they decided to further their educations. Most of these women did not leave the men in their lives. They engaged in constructive strategies of resistance. One woman I spoke with was inhibited because her husband worked in a plant and she felt uncomfortable having more education than he did. Yet she wanted to re-enter the workforce and needed an advanced degree to do so. She made the choice to take responsibility for her needs and desires, believing it would also enhance the well-being of her family. Returning to work boosted her self-esteem and changed the passive-aggressive rage and depression that had developed as a consequence of her isolation and stagnation. Making this decision, returning to work boosted her self-esteem and changed the passive-aggressive rage and depression that had developed as a consequence of her isolation and stagnation. Making this decision and finding ways to realize it was not an easy process, however. Her husband and children were often disgruntled when her independence forced them to accept more household responsibilities. Aw, sorry, not sorry. In the long run, everyone benefited, and it goes without saying that these changes boosted her self-esteem in ways that showed her how self-love made it possible to extend herself in a constructive way to others. She was happier, and so were those around her. In order to make these changes, she had to make use of another vital aspect of self-esteem, self-assertiveness, defined by Branden as the willingness to stand up for myself, to be who I am openly, to treat myself with respect in all human encounters. Since many of us were shamed in childhood, either in our families of origin or in our school settings, a learned pattern of going along with the program and not making a fuss is the course of action we most frequently choose as a way to avoid conflict. As children, conflict was often the setting for put-downs and humiliation, the place where we were shamed. Our attempts at self-assertion failed as an adequate defense. Many of us learned that passivity lessened the possibility of attack. Sexist socialization teaches females that self-assertiveness is a threat to femininity. Accepting this faulty logic lays the groundwork for low self-esteem. The fear of being self-assertive usually surfaces in women who have been trained to be good girls or dutiful daughters. In our childhood home, my brother was never punished for talking back, Asserting his opinions was a positive sign of manhood. When my sisters and I voiced our opinions, we were told by our parenting adults that this was negative and undesirable behavior. We were told, especially by our dad, that female self-assertion was not feminine. We did not listen to these warnings. Even though ours was a patriarchal household, the fact that females far outnumbered the two males, my dad, my brother, made it safe for us to speak our minds and talk back, Ache. Luckily, by the time we were young adults, the feminist movement had come along and validated that having a voice and being assertive was necessary for building self-esteem. One reason women have traditionally gossiped more than men is because gossip has been a social interaction wherein women have felt comfortable stating what they really think and feel. That's interesting. Often, rather than asserting what they think at the appropriate moment, women say what they think they will what they think will please the listener. Later, they gossip, stating at that moment their true thoughts. This division between a false self invented to please others and a more authentic self need not exist when we cultivate positive self-esteem. This division between a false self invented to please others and the more authentic self need not exist when we cultivate positive self-esteem. And so we come as we are, right? We come as we are. I'm going to stop there. I'm stopping at page 60. Word. Let's close out this meditation, fam. Take what you need. What do you need today? What do you need today? What's the affirmation today? Take responsibility for my dreams, for my goals, for my actions, for my words. I take full responsibility for how I respond at any given moment. I am responsible for my happiness. I am responsible for my healing. I am responsible for what? Family, I'm wishing you the most amazing day. Ache, amen, namaste, and so it is. The book is titled All About Love. We out here. I heard about this book from Imani, the hood healer, months and months and months ago. She talks about this book a lot and reads it with the Soul Family. And I've been reading it for months now, just kind of like pieces at a time, because we can read a book, but it means nothing if we're not applying what we're learning, if we're not taking what we need from it. It means nothing. You know, so it's good that we're reading a little bit at a time. That way, take what you need, take what feels good, and let go of the rest. We're on page 60. I am enough. Yes. Yes. Grand rising, yo. Sending love right back to Africa. Grand rising. We are awake. Today's gonna be an amazing day. Someone asked a question. Let me see. Oh, you got the title. Family, have a beautiful day. Gotcha.